prayers. Okay, so now there is time for our special moment honoring grandparents.
Good morning, everyone. I hope you are having a wonderful day on this day that the Lord has made. Today is a special day, not only here in our church, but throughout the United States. It is an official national holiday, probably not as well known as some of the others, but perhaps, I believe, more equally important. This is Grandparents' Day. It was signed by President Jimmy Carter in 1978, and today is the day that we honor the impact that the grandparents have on their grandchildren and the special bond that they have with them also. Before I turn it over to Jackie, I want to give special thanks for a couple of people. Cindy for the games and the bulletin board she did, Diane for her beautiful altar, Anna for doing the video and encouraging the youth to participate, Karen Kelly and Pastor Karen for their input, and now for Jackie for her poem.
Grandparents are special people with wisdom and pride. They are always offering love and kindness and are always there to guide. They often make you feel confident and strong. Their arms are always open no matter what you did wrong. They try to help out in every way they can. They love all of their grandchildren the same, whether you're a child, woman, or man. They are always there to listen, to lend a helping hand, and show you respect and try to understand. They give their love, devotion, and so much more that's easy to see. Grandparents, what perfect examples of the kind of person that we should be. Please enjoy this video from our members and their families, grandparents. Please stand, and the children and youth will bring you a gift.
I like my grandparents because they're fun, they're silly, and they take care of me. Goodbye.
Happy Grandparents' Day! One thing that I love about my grandmother is the memories that we share together, whether it be recent memories like me taking over her kitchen, or older memories of her tucking me in at night when I would spend the night and reading me stories.
My favorite thing about my granny is that she is my favorite person in the whole world. She's my best friend. She always knows how to make me feel better and laugh no matter what I'm going through.
My favorite thing about her is that she's loved me like her own since the day I was born, and she's been there for me even when I didn't have a grandmother.
We love you!
Love you!
Okay, I've been asked why I like being a grandmother, and I think probably the first thing that comes to my head is I love it because it was a surprise. I really didn't think grandchildren were in my future, so having my granddaughter has been wonderful to see the world through her eyes. And I think probably the first time that I went somewhere and she was on a playground and she turned around and saw me and she came running to me. And I think that when your children have children, they really learn what love is all about. And I can see my daughter now knowing how much I love her because of how much she loves Rayleigh.
Or who she'd come to when they came. This is about 18 months.
Our one granddaughter.
But anyway, she came running up the driveway, just, you know, smiling and just as fast as her feet would go. And then I reached down to lift her up, and she says, went right by me and saying, "Doggy, doggy, dog was behind me."
I love being a grandparent in order to engage in a lot of the activities that my grandchildren like, some of them of which, you know, I helped them get an interest in, one being my granddaughter, and I taught her how to sew, and we made American Girl doll clothes, and she loved it. Now she's getting a little older and's kind of outgrown that, and my husband loves sports, and so we've been able to go to all their games that they've had and water sports and everything, so I love being active with them.
All of my grandchildren, each one by one, call me on my birthday and wish me a happy birthday, and I thought that was wonderful.
I love being a grandparent, and I love being a great-grandparent, and I love to have the kids with me, and I know that they're taken care of.
I love Shig and Ham because they are funny, caring, and they take good care of me.
Pam, what's something that you love about being a grandparent?
Hi, everyone. I'm so excited to be a grandparent. I love sharing things that are important to me with the grandkids. And at the same time, they share with me what they love to do also. We get to have a lot of fun, and it's just such a blessing to be a part of their lives, and I just adore it.
I like that because my grandparents let me swim in the water.
And I like when we build Legos.
I like how grandparents let me stay at their house.
That's fun, isn't it?
We love you,
BB
and Pop-Pop!
Hi, I've been asked to comment about what I like about being a grandparent. Well, the best thing is to have my grandkids around me, having fun with them, cutting up, playing, teaching them new things, watching them learn stuff. And then there's always filling them with sugar and taking them home. But then there's the good part. I get to watch my sons go through all that stuff that I went through with them for all those years, make all these lines on me. And the best part, they hadn't even became teenagers yet.
What I like about being a grandmother, or what I love about being a grandmother, is how excited my grandchildren get every time they come over here to see me. And I love to hear them call my name, BB, and when they run in the room and give me a hug. And another thing that I really love about being a grandparent is how much my grandchildren love coming to this church and all the people here in this church. And that's it.
Yeah, I love being a grandparent. Number one, I only have one grandchild, but she is just about perfect and has been her whole life.
I have one granddaughter, and I love everything about her. She and I go to school together. I see her at school, and she's always hugging me in the hallway. And we come home, we do schoolwork together, and I love her.
Reasons I love Grandnan and Grandma. I love Grandma because she teaches me piano and makes sure I get my work done. I love Grandnan because he teaches me a lot about history and tells me some pretty funny jokes.
I love my grandparents because they taught me how to help other people while working at their food pantry.
I like my grandparents because they spend time with me, come to my sporting events, and take me to Chick-fil-A.
Hey, Mom and G-Daddy, I love you both. G-Daddy, I love that you come to my games to support me, Mimi, and I love everything that you cook.
Hey, Mimi and G-Daddy, I love you guys both. G-Daddy, you're very funny. Mimi, I love your pizza.
All right, Miss Diana, what's something that you love about being a grandparent?
Well, I love watching their little personalities develop from day one all the way up to being grown up and going off to college this year, like we have one. And I love getting to have fun with them, and then you take them home to mom and dad.
I love having these two tiny humans, to see them experience life, to learn things, to laugh. It makes me feel young again, being around young people. And I'm loving the heck out of being a grandparent because they give me so much energy. I appreciate the hugs, the kisses, the notes and letters that I get from them. It makes me very proud.
She likes to sit on her swing bench, and me and Eli blow bubbles, and she's like, ah, bubble attack. She likes to play hide the frog.
What does that mean? What does she do?
She hides the frog in her house, and she gives us hints, and we tell us if we're hot or cold.
I love being called Nana, and I love all the hugs and the cuddles. And the other day I went over to visit Kaylin and Jackson, and they come running up the door to greet me, arms wide open, smiling and saying, "Nana!" And it just really warmed my heart. It's a great feeling. Love being a Nana.
The thing I love most, that's kind of hard to pick just one thing. I love having my grandkids around because I love them both. And I love experiencing activities with them, going on vacations. And
one of the things I think I miss most when Chrissy grew up and I wasn't doing it anymore was getting and taking the children to see things that they had never seen before, and the excitement in doing something for the first time. I miss.
What I love about them is that they cook food for me sometimes and everything, and they take me a Boy Scout.
That I love about my grandparents is that no matter the day, time, or place, they've always been there for me. They've offered to take me anywhere that I need to whenever I don't have a ride places. They've been like my backbone throughout my entire life, and I thank them for a lot of things, like for everything, really.
Spending time with my grandma, because I always get old stories about my great-grandma and grandpa and just extended family, a lot that I haven't even met, and it's just cool to know more about my family.
I love getting to do all the things with them that I got to do with my kids. Carving pumpkins, trick-or-treating, Easter baskets, you know, Easter egg hunts, all those little playtime things that I used to do with my kids, I'm getting to do all over again with them.
I appreciate that, and I appreciate and love that my grandparents pick me up from school every day from kindergarten up until 7th grade. And they spend time with me.
I love my grandparents because they bring me to movies and they tell stupid jokes and they play words with friends with me.
What I think is the best part of being a grandparent is being able to see those little children that you had so long ago mimicked right in their own parents' likenesses. And I get to see the same things that drove me crazy drive their parents crazy.
I love Mimi and Papa because they are gonna come to my softball games and they invite us to do anything they're doing.
I love my Mimi and Papa because they'll take me places I need to go. Like today I needed to get my braces checked out. So my Mimi took me to the orthodontist and we went and got Chick-fil-A after. And my Papa is taking me to a Georgia game this Saturday. Go Dogs, love y'all.
I love my Mimi and Papa because my Papa always takes me to basketball games and golfing. And I love Mimi because she always scratches my head and brings me lunch. Love y'all.
We love seeing our grandchildren grow up, especially the boys to the fine young men that they have become, and that sweet little girl, my goodness.
Watching them go through the different stages of their life, involved in various activities, and seeing our own children mirrored in our grandchildren.
Good morning. Happy Grandparents' Day. Being a grandmother is just one of the best things ever. Such joy, such fun, such happiness. I leave you with a quote from Alex Haley. Nobody can do for little children what grandparents do. Grandparents sort of sprinkle stardust over the lives of little children. Happy Grandparents' Day, and I'm thankful for Stella, Vivian, and Luna.
The theme for the altar this morning is the apple of my eye, because our grandchildren, great-grandchildren, great-great-grandchildren in some cases, they are the apple of our eyes, the most special, most precious thing in our lives. Cindy has carried the theme out with her bulletin board, and I invite you to have a look at that in the hallway where there are pictures of grandchildren posted, and then you have a chance to take an apple and write the name that your grandchildren call you. And it's interesting to see the variety of names that grandparents have. It's easy to get misty-eyed over the idea of grandchildren. So I thought I would leaven things up a bit this morning. Recall an incident in a supermarket not too many years ago. A woman in a supermarket is following a grandfather and his badly behaved three-year-old grandson. It's obvious to her that he has his hands full, with the child screaming for candy in the candy aisle, cookies in the cookie aisle, and for cereal and soda in the other aisles. Obviously, we're not in the South here. Meanwhile, Granddad is working his way around, saying in a controlled voice, "Easy, William. We won't be long. Easy, boy." Another outburst, and she hears the granddad calmly say, "It's okay, William. Just a couple more minutes and we'll be out of here. Hang in there, boy." At the checkout, the little Tara is throwing items out of the cart, and granddad says again in a controlled voice, "William, William, relax, buddy. Don't get upset. We'll be home in 5 minutes. Stay cool, William." Very impressed, the woman goes outside where the grandfather is loading his groceries and the boy into the car. She says to the elderly gentleman, "It's none of my business, but you were amazing in there. I don't know how you did it. The whole time you kept your composure, and no matter how loud and disruptive he got, you just calmly kept saying things would be okay. William is very lucky to have you as his grandpa." "Thanks," said the grandfather, "but I'm William." Jerking his thumb toward the three-year-old, grandpa said, "His name's Timmy." And I was thinking, when Anna asked me to share some thoughts with you this morning, that maybe grandparents need to be given a shopping list. When mom and dad take the baby home from the hospital, they get a lot of information, books and gifts and suggestions and recommendations, but sometimes grandparents feel left out. So here's the grandparents' shopping list. In your basket, you will want to put patience. When that grandchild says, "Nanny, just one more chorus of Froggy Went A-Courtin'," and you have sung it 39 times, you will need patience to go for a... to go for a 40th rendition. And I'm convinced this is why God lets old people repeat themselves ad infinitum. You will need stamina. When that cherubic grandchild says, "Papa, just one more ride on the pony," and Papa is the pony, and the old gray mare, I'm sorry, the old gray stallion, he ain't what he used to be, but he will go one more round to please his grandson. Never mind that he will spend the next few days in his stall under a heating pad and a blanket. And grandparents, you will need wisdom. wisdom. I think about a friend of mine who's summed up life experience in this adage, "This too shall pass." Now, he would often trot that out in a difficult circumstance, meaning to be encouraging, that no matter how bad things seem, they eventually will resolve themselves and life will go on. But grandparents know something else. "This too shall pass" means that that sweet little four-year-old who thinks you hung the moon, stars, in fact, all the celestial bodies, will in about 10 years look at you as if you live on the dark side of the moon. So you know to enjoy those sweet moments because you know they are fleeting. And grandparents, you will need a sense of community and continuity. You know that you are part of the cycle of life. As trite as that sounds, it really is true. And you know that you are part of something greater than yourself. You know that when you look at your grandchildren, you see your immortality. And you see in them, as several of our grandparents have pointed out this morning, you see in them traits of your children, maybe of your own grandparents. And you realize that, hey, Gramps, I have more in common with my grandchildren than just the fact that all of us wear disposable diapers.
And spontaneity.
You know about living in the moment, because despite careful planning, life is often unrehearsed. Have you ever been riding through the wilds of Idaho or South Dakota or Montana, and the little voice from the back seat says, "But Nanny, I've got to go now"? That's why God planted bushes along the roadside. And last but not least, grandparents, a sense of humor. When your 7-year-old fashionista granddaughter is critiquing your latest outfit that she actually helped you select on the program The Cutting Edge, and you ordered it from Amazon, and it came a kimono with more patterns and shades than Joseph's amazing Technicolor dream coat, paired with Chartreuse palazzo pants, and you are doing the catwalk, and your 7-year-old granddaughter says, after some reflection, "Well, Gummy, it looked better on the model." Never mind, the model weighed 82 pounds and she was 7 feet tall. And then I suppose to make things better, she looks at you with a kind of sad little face and she says, "Gummy, your neck looks old and tired." And you reply, "That's because it's been holding up my giant brain for 73 years. So I don't know that grandparents, maybe they don't need a sense of sarcasm, okay? But you can teach your grandchildren a sense of irony. And thank you.
Thank you, Gummy.
Thank you, grandchildren.
All right, let us go to our Lord in prayer then. Gracious Heavenly Father, to you be all honor and glory. We thank you, as always, for opportunities to gather in your name wherever we may be, a especially in this beautiful, comfortable sanctuary that we worship in. We thank you, Lord, for loving us, because sometimes it may not be very easy. We thank you, Lord, for the blessings you have bestowed upon us. And those blessings are many, and especially in persons of grandparents. We thank you, Lord, for those grandparents and for those individuals who have served in that capacity for us. We thank you for the patience, for the spontaneity, for the time that they have spent with their grandchildren, their great-grandchildren. And we thank you, Lord, for the influence that they have made on our lives. We ask you, Lord, to remember those who could not be here this morning, especially our dear pastor, Karen. Keep Karen and Judy Settle and Laura Santos in the palm of your hand, as well as the Wiley family and those related to George in Northeast Georgia, all friends and family. We ask you, Lord, also, as we celebrated Remembrance Day on Saturday, September the 11th, it was a celebration of life, and at the same time, Lord, it was commemoration for those who gave their lives 20 years ago in an attack on our country that has never been surpassed. We pray, Lord, that our remembrance will be fond for those individuals whose names we will never know, but those individuals who were there that day to use their skills, their talents, their abilities, their graces for rescue and recover, and those who lost their lives in doing so. We have so many things for which to be grateful. Today is a beautiful day. We are in the midst of friends and family. We have seen how much grandparents mean to their grandchildren. We know how much grandchildren mean to us who are grandparents. And we ask you, Lord, to always keep those memories tucked within our hearts, and that our grandchildren will remember us in fond ways, and that when they are in that position, they will say, Mimi did this, Pops did this, Nana did this. Let us remember those persons in our lives who have been ever so important, our family and our friends, and especially, Lord, you, for without you, we would not be here. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you for supporting our ministries. There are many ways to give to our church. You can give digitally at mfumc.com/give or the Morrow FUMC app. You can leave it in the plate at rear and front of the sanctuary, or you can mail to P.O. Box 143, Morrow, Georgia, 30260. You can also drop off during office hours Monday through Wednesday, 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. Loving God, Jesus taught us where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. We offer our gifts to you knowing they are part of our treasure. And we do so with the hope that our hearts, our actions, and the words of our tongues will likewise follow. We acknowledge that the tongues that praise you are often the ones that hurt you. When we use them to diminish or discount one of your precious children, guide our hearts, minds, and tongues to the words that bring you joy. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
That's wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. And Jackie and Jaden on the piano, that's great. And all of the instrumentalists that helped Diane with her children's moment this morning. And everything that Anna has done and her committee have done for Grandparents Day. Thank you so much. We really appreciate it. When I realized that I would be standing up here this morning, I was trying to think about something that I could say that would tie in with grandparents. Needless to say, I would not be able to duplicate what Pastor Karen would say. But I began to think about my own grandmother, who was, she called herself a hard-shelled Methodist. Now, I never heard anybody outside the Baptist faith, Baptist denomination, use the phrase hard-shelled. But my granny did, and she was a granny to everybody who lived in that little bitty town of Fruithurst, Alabama. There was one caution light, and I think my oldest cousin actually shot it out one night when he was target practicing, and he was trying to hit something else and hit the caution light. Granny's name was Mary Naomi, and everybody called her either Granny or Omi. She reminded me of a mustard seed. Tiny, but powerful. My mother reminds me of a mustard seed also. Tiny, but powerful. Mama was 5'2" in her stocking feet, she said. I don't think my grandmother reached 5 feet in her lifetime. She was a small person. But I thought about them, and I thought about the mustard seed, and I thought it's a mighty little thing, the mustard seed, but think about what it does. I actually use it in cooking. I use it in soups and salads. I even put it in some of the black-eyed peas that I cook. You might try it sometime. It's not bad at all. So the scripture that I chose this morning comes from Mark, the 4th chapter, verses 26 through 33, and I'd like to share that scripture with you. I believe Cora has it on the screen. Hear these words. He, Jesus, also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes on and with his sickle, because the harvest time has come." He also said, "What can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet, when it grows, when it's sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. And he did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I think about the wisdom of Jesus Christ. Think about the wisdom of the persons in your life, your grandparents, your parents, or someone else that has really been an important part of your life. Someone once wrote that the wisdom of Jesus Christ is like a press conference in which Jesus answers all the questions about God and salvation that the disciples could think of. They all asked questions. Jesus was constantly being questioned. The Sermon on the Mount, the answers he gave to those who asked about eternal life, when he was teaching the apostles to pray, and certainly teaching through the parables. He understood that to teach a person, you must reach a person. And anyone who has taught school understands that a child who comes to school hungry is not receptive to learning until that hunger is satisfied. Adults are pretty much the same. Whatever the hunger is, it must be satisfied before we can hope to move on. And we all like good stories.
Those who heard the parables of Jesus were pulled in by the storylines, but more importantly, they were inspired by the spiritual messages that the stories had. Parables were meant to reveal and not conceal. And we are fortunate enough to have our scripture where Jesus uses the parables as the teaching methods. And we can sit around and discuss them and talk about them, and we can learn from them years, thousands of years after Jesus shared them with the disciples. And yet, sometimes they fail to understand for a while. The area where Jesus lived was an agrarian society, and so the matters of soil, as are mentioned in this parable, and seeds and sowing and plowing and harvesting were all familiar to them. My grandmother picked cotton. My mother picked cotton. You probably had some parents and grandparents that picked cotton also. Those who lived on farms or those who lived in rural areas and sometimes had to provide for their own food sources and maybe even for their neighbors as well. Jesus' audience was born in religious communities of the Galilee. They knew scripture by memory and they believed that one God in the covenant which God had made with Israel, the coming of the Messiah. So he had a perfect message for a perfect setting for testing all the messages, all the stories that he told in the parables. Now, I didn't know very much about mustard seed when I started working on this this message, but I did learn that there are 40 different varieties and they grow in various parts of the world, mostly in India and in the Middle East. It takes 200 seeds to cover the face of a penny. That's how tiny they are. Mustard plants grow close together and create a thicket that resembles a tree and becomes a home to many species of birds, insects, rodents. It's like an ecosystem of its own. Hearing some of the children talk about being close to their grandparents, almost growing in a thicket with those grandparents, being a part of their lives and being so close to them and feeling even the heartbeat of their grandparents. Mustard seeds, the plants, will grow to a height of 8 to 10 feet if left alone. And if left allowed, they will take over anything. It's like our kudzu in the South. You know, it seems to me that there should be some positive use of kudzu. We have so much of it, and we'd be glad to share with anybody who wants it. The stems on the mustard tree, and it can grow to be a tree, can grow to be about as thick as a grown man's arm. And it's nearly impossible to cut them down unless you use a machete or a chainsaw. And if you do cut it down, it grows back from its roots. How many times have Christians bounced back? How many times have grandparents been there when grandchildren needed a place to bounce back? How many times do we provide the soil, we as grandparents provide the soil in which those children grow? The mustard seeds are normally planted in the fields where the plants would not choke out the other vegetation. And even different varieties of mustard seed were cultivated in a space large enough that the plants themselves wouldn't take over somewhere else. If this is the way of the mustard seed, then why would Jesus use it as an illustration for the kingdom of God? It appears that Jesus chose the mustard seed because of its size. These are black mustard seeds, but there are also some that are yellow. Some my age, my generation, may have had a mustard seed enclosed in glass. It was glass, I believe, or heavy plastic many years ago in 19-boopity-boop. A lot of the young ladies in my fifth grade class had mustard seeds, and they were yellow in color. Farmers knew the benefits of the mustard seed and plant. The seeds were ground and mixed with honey for sauces, honey mustard, salad dressing in Israel. Or they were ground up as a spice. The seed was used as an oil in poultices, and the leaves were boiled and seasoned with spice. so they could be used as food additives or for drinking. So much from a little seed. So much from my 5'1" mother and my not yet 5' tall grandmother. If everything surrounding the first century peasant life seemed in short supply, the description of the kingdom of God, as insignificant as the mustard seed is, must have been received wonderfully well by those people. So much can grow from so little. If this small seed could produce so much, what could God do? If one smile or one hug or one from a grandparent, and I've done that before, can communicate with that grandchild, that one small thing goes so far. Those of you who are not yet grandparents but will be someday, just remember how important it is that you have your grandparents in your life. I did not know my grandfathers. I had two grandmothers, one that lived in Alabama and one that lived in Texas, whom I rarely saw. The one in Alabama was the one that had the faith of a mustard seed. My mother inherited that faith. I would like to say that I did as well. Mustard seeds grow and spread and give life. So do grandparents. They grow, they spread, they give life, another life, another life, and so on. In modern democracy, it was a small seed that planted the Magna Carta in 1215. The Missouri River, the longest river in North America, begins in the Rocky Mountains as Browser Spring. And then it travels over 2,000 miles east and south before it goes to the Mississippi River. A baby was born in Bethlehem, and the world has never been the same. 2.9 billion people profess to be Christians. So what seeds are we planting? How can we be a mustard seed? Each time we extend a hand of friendship, each time we take a step toward forgiveness, each time we act with love and patience, I need that musical instrument with patience. Each time we generously give of our time and talents and resources, each time we extend peace and comfort to a troubled person, each time we listen to the needs of others and do what we can to alleviate any problems, each time we see injustice and work toward discovering the cause, each time we plant a garden and tend it with care. Each time we share what we have planted or what has been sown in our hearts, as grandparents do with their grandchildren. Our mustard seed scatterings may not flourish immediately. We may not see them for a while, or maybe ever, depending on how long we are privileged to live. But we have invested a little of ourselves in God's kingdom on earth when we have grandchildren and great-grandchildren. You may remember a song from the 1990s. Bette Midler sang the song. It's called From a Distance. The song talks about how from a distance the world looks blue and green and snow-capped mountains are white. And from a distance there is harmony and no guns or bombs or disease, and God is watching us from a distance. It's a lovely song with its images of peace and harmony that you almost find yourself believing it, but I don't, because God is not at a distance. God is in the mustard seed. God is in the hearts of grandparents, parents. God is in the hearts of all of us if we open our hearts and let Him in through the Holy Spirit. This God is the God who came to earth to be among us, who reduced Himself to the scant, insignificant life of a poor carpenter, who entered into the dirt and the mud and the pain and the suffering, and who gently but persistently cracks open new life, just like that mustard seed, cracks open new life. I don't know about you. I don't want to be known as the kudzu woman. However, I do like the idea of being like the mustard seed. Maybe a little plant, maybe a little scruffy on the outside. Very hardy, difficult to control, ask Bob. And impossible to get rid of, ask Bob. And most certainly, growing from roots planted long ago and dropping seeds along the way to spread the word of God, who is as close as our own breath. Just like the grandparent holds the grandchild in his or her lap and their hearts beat as one. Long live the role of grandparents. Amen.
Our closing song is hymn number 507, Through It All. We'll stand together and we'll sing it through twice.
I thank you very much for being here this morning, especially staying when you found out Pastor Karen was not here. I appreciate that very much. And to Anna and her committee, and to Pam. All right, Pam was in. Fran and Anna and Diane and Karen and anyone else who... Cindy Lou. Oh, yes, Cindy Lou and her candy baskets. Thank you very much. We thank you very much. This has been a memorable Grandparents' Day. And Anna, you were very sneaky because I saw the three Orvitz children up there. You did that, and I thank you very much. I looked, that's Georgia Ann. And then Garrett, my sweet. Karen, Pastor Karen, when you listen to this, when you feel like it, we hope that we have done what you might have done in some small way. We are praying for you, and we thank you very much for being our pastor. And now, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And we all said together,
amen.
Go and have a wonderful afternoon.